Hello everyone, and welcome to NetSeminar. Today's speaker comes from Italy, Luigi Rizzo. He comes from University of Pisa, and he's also spending some time visiting Google for 6 months. Luigi has done quite a lot of work in networking and systems, so if you use DummyNet at any time in OSX or PBSD, you have to thank Luigi for this. He's also done work in packet scheduling, congestion control, and today he's going to talk about some recent work that he's done on a framework for fast I/O called NetApp. So, Luigi?
Okay, thanks for the introduction, and feel free to ask a question even during the talk. I try to answer or postpone the answer if I cover the topic later in the slides. So the goal of today's talk is to show you how we can improve the performance of network processing in standard OS in ways that probably are not matching the original design of the network stacks in the Unix-like systems. And the reason why I chose this picture is because in the end, you will see the solution that I use, and you will think, oh, was it so easy? And yes, in the end, it was so easy. But I've been working in this area for a long time, 15 years, and I felt so stupid when I found when I designed NetMap, because all the technology that I've been using could have been used 10 years ago, and I didn't realize that. So it was easy, but after you know the solution, everything is easy. So this is joint work with some of my former students in Pisa and colleagues, and also it's funded by the European project. Every now and then there is good outcome from European projects. And if you are bored by my face, you can look at the slides online. So the question is the following. Suppose you have to write some packet processing applications. What are your options? And I'm trying to list here what are the possibilities that you have with the mainstream operating systems. So one option is to use the sockets. Socket API is very flexible. You can do almost anything, including sending and receiving raw packets. It's been available for a long time on most operating systems. It has only one problem. It's very slow. And it's very slow for a number of reasons that we will see. The other option is to try and use some direct packet I/O systems that exist. For instance, Linux has pfpacket, or a variant which is called pfring. There are other systems that also expose the hardware to user space, so you can program the registers of the card directly. The problem is the following here. If you use one solution such as pfpacket or pfring, the underlying mechanism to move packets between the network card and the operating system is still based on skbuffs and mbuffs, depending on the operating systems, and that's a very slow mechanism. So it's like having a very fast car where you do direct packet I/O. It's equivalent to having a very fast car and very fast engine, but you're using this car on a road which is very slow. So in the end, you would not be able to exploit the performance of the system. The other option is to run your code directly into the kernel, which is great, except when you make mistakes and write to the wrong memory location. So you might crash the entire system. And of course, there are manufacturers who sell you hardware and software together. For instance, Solarflare has this library which is called Open Onload, which is a OS bypass library which lets you use sockets from a user space application and control directly the hardware bypassing the operating system. Intel has the PDK, it's a similar library. This is tied to vendor hardware, so you don't know what's going on inside the system. You trust the vendor to do the right thing. Unfortunately, if you're moving to a different card or the vendor goes out of business, you're in trouble, because many of the extensions that the vendor has supplied are probably not available anymore. So I was looking at this problem and trying to figure out, is there any any way we can implement direct packet I/O from a user space application directly to the wire and vice versa. And can we do it in a way which is fast, which is safe, doesn't suffer from the crash risks that you have with some other option, and it's hardware independent? And yes, there is a way, and we eventually built a prototype which is quite flexible. It's even quite small in terms of code size, which is good. It's maintainable, so I don't have to rewrite a device driver for from scratch, which is a major major piece of work, or would be a major piece of work otherwise. And the results that we achieved are shown in these slides. For instance, if you say you have an application which wants to send packets, raw packets, to a network interface, if you use sockets, you have this kind of performance. So I'm using, I'm plotting this graph with variable clock speeds, because our system is so fast that it saturates the link at top speed. So if you want to see how fast is our system, we need to underclock the CPU to get the exact performance point. But anyways, if you take a socket-based application, you are getting more or less 1 million packets per second at top CPU speed, and then decreases linearly with the clock speed. There are better solutions. For instance, in Linux, there is a kernel model which is called PacketGen. Some of you might have used it, and it peaks at around 4 million packets per second. And with our solution, with NetMap, we saturate the link with one core at 900 megahertz. So there's more than one order of magnitude.
We'll probably talk about this later, but I guess one other way of sort of measuring it would be to change your packet size and use like minimum size packets.
This is all with minimum size packets.
This is all minimum size packets.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
So yeah, I mean,
some out of ideas.
Many papers you read, you will find the performance megabits per second or gigabits per second.
Okay. Yeah.
Million of packets per second.
So 14 million times 64 equals 10 gigabits. I guess.
More, if you include the overhead, the framing. Okay. So yeah, 14.88 is the magic number for the 10 gigabits.
For 64 byte.
For 64 bytes. Yes. I was saying, NetMap has this performance. It uses its own API, which might be a problem if it forces you to rewrite all of your software. Fortunately, the API that NetMap exposes is very simple and compatible with libpcap. You have a file descriptor, so you can select on it. And in fact, we have a libpcap emulation library, which is very small and lets you run an unmodified application even without recompiling on top of NetMap. Now, the rest of the talk will be on how we managed to do this, and hopefully some of the ideas that we used can be applied to some other contexts, and some of your projects. And so the first thing we did, actually it wasn't the first thing, but after we built the system, we tried to figure out why it is so fast. And so at some point, we measured the time at the stack and trying to figure out where the time was spent in sending the packet. And You know immediately if you look at the code that the network stack is heavily layered. So data from the socket down to the network card pass through several layers. And in principle, you might think, okay, maybe there is one place where most of the time is spent. I fix that place and I'm good. And reality is not like that, unfortunately. But to realize that, what we did was run a set of measurements. And the thing we want to measure is the time spent at every layer in the network stack. And those times can be very small, tens of nanoseconds or even less. So small that it becomes really complex to measure them, even using the TSC timer on the CPU. So we did in a different way. We instrumented the code so that at various stages in the flow of the packet from the socket to the device driver, we basically insert some return statements, freeing resources if it's necessary. And then we measure the packet rate aborting the processing at different stages. And by the reciprocal of this number is the time spent to process the packet up to that level. And then by difference, we can compute how much time is spent at every day. And of course, in order to do this, we needed to run a fast traffic generator in user space, make sure that wasn't the bottleneck, and then move down the stack and see how much time is spent at every level. And the measurement was done on a relatively cheap system, Intel i7 CPU, with a 10 gig interface at the bottom. You don't need the interface until you reach this point. You don't need the network card until you reach that point. But anyways. And this was done on FreeBSD. Linux is somewhat similar, maybe slightly more efficient in some cases because it uses different locking mechanisms. But for instance, the device driver is as expensive in Linux as it is in FreeBSD. Now, the numbers are like this. So the way to read it is this table. Basically, in the second column, you see the list of functions that are called from sender to down to sending the packet to the wire. And this column tells you how much time is spent for sending a packet if you abort processing at that level. So if you abort right before send two, it takes a nanosecond for the user space generator to create one packet. If you abort after IP output, before IP output, it takes 330 nanoseconds, and so on. And if you get down to the wire, you spend on FreeBSD approximately 950 nanoseconds per packet. Now, if you look at this table, you see that apart from having 10 or more different layers, that there isn't a single place where a lot of time is spent. And actually, there are many places, and you see them emphasized in this column. There are many places where there is a significant amount of time spent in that layer. For instance, just in the device drivers, 120 nanoseconds. Consider that at the top packet rate on a 10 gig interface, your budget is 67 nanoseconds per packet. So this is already a showstopper. And the Ether output, which does a very trivial thing, collecting the MAC addresses for the packet, spends another 169 seconds. IP output computes the IP header, another almost one. The system call at the beginning takes 96 nanoseconds, and that's basically something you cannot avoid. If you want to move from protected ring to ring zero, to the kernel, you need to pay that cost. So,
can you just explain again how you measure these from the loopback mechanism for the packet generator?
So yeah, okay. So I modify the kernel sources.
Yeah.
And so, for instance, at some point, the code calls IP output.
Yeah.
Right before the code calls IP output. Yes, right before the code calls IP output, I return instead of calling the function.
I see.
Okay. So and that's one point. And then I can make the return right before the IP transmit and so on. Okay. So I don't need to put to collect timestamps on every packet. But I just do the measurement on 1 second, I see how many packets are transmitted in 1 second, and then compute the time. Now, it's very similar to the picture I showed before with all the stages. Now, how do we fix that? How do we move the code, or how do we modify the code so that we can send and receive packets in the 60 nanoseconds that we have available? As I said, the system call is the one thing that cannot be avoided. You need to pay the cost if you want some protection. And you do want some protection because we are humans, we make mistakes. So I want my system to be safe. So the way to reduce the cost of the system call is, of course, amortizing it on a batch of packets. But other things can be saved. For instance, a lot of time spent in the device driver is for programming the device to send one packet at a time. And again, if you try to move batches of packets from the application to the network card, you can amortize some costs. Some other costs can be saved. For instance, those related to data copies and buffer allocation. The mbuf or skbuf is the internal representation in the kernel of a network packet. Turns out that the operating system allocates and frees a buffer every time you want to send or receive a packet, and that's a very expensive operation. For certain applications, you don't need to do that, or you can do the allocation in advance, and then recycles the buffers as you produce traffic or receive traffic. And so on. There are many tricks that you can use in different places, but mostly it's about removing unnecessary operation and amortizing the cost of the One thing which is a particularly bad idea, is the fact that the internal representation of packets in the kernel, it's very complex. Basically, the mbuf or the skbuf can be a list of chunks of memory where you store the packet. And that was very convenient 30 years ago because memory was expensive and the packets were constructed on a step-by-step basis. So you start with the payload, the TCP header in front of it, and an MP header, and so on. So you didn't want to copy data at the time, and so the most natural way to create a packet was to create a linked list of buffers with the small chunks representing all the various layers. And in recent times, what happened is that people found that packet processing was expensive, so started to offload the features to the network card. For instance, when it turned out that IP check or TCP checksum were expensive, cards came out with hardware checksums. When it came out, when VLANs came out, again, cards implemented VLAN tag insertion and removal in hardware. And in order to tell the hardware whether you should use or not these features, the packet representation was also extended. So in the end, it's like playing a Tetris game with the packets that have very different shapes, and the network card has to juggle with those shapes and in order to improve performance. Life would be a lot simpler if you had a Tetris game like the one on the left. All the blocks are the same size, very uniform, and you don't have to think when you process them. And this is exactly one of the things we did in NetMap to improve our packet performance. So, now, the measurement I showed was for sockets. And when you do raw packet I/O, you don't need many of the layers that the socket implements. You don't need to add IP headers, you don't need to add MAC headers. The packet is already prepared and so on. So we started from that simple problem. And then some of the ideas that we use can be also used to improve the performance of the network stack. And this is work that we have not done yet. One other reason to work on raw packet I/O is that this is useful to determine the maximum performance that you can get from the system. It's also poorly supported by current APIs, because whether you use BPF or raw sockets, etc., you still have to spend a lot of time processing the packets. So there is a lot of return in working on this problem. And as I said, the guidelines were the following. First of all, I didn't want to rely on special other features because I would limit myself or device on a given vendor. Anyways, I wouldn't be compatible with some of these things. If I have some costs that cannot be avoided, then I want to amortize them. If I have some things that can be avoided, I remove them. And in general, reduce runtime decisions. Every time you need to make a decision in the code, you have to take a jump, possibly have a cache miss on the instruction cache or in the prefetch unit or in the jump predictor. So these things are very expensive and should be avoided. And the other thing I was a little bit concerned was in the operating system, you have many device drivers. So if you do something that requires modifications to the device driver, you are going to have to do a lot of work to make your system work with all the hardware that is supported. So modifications were permitted, but as long as the code could be maintained. So as long as the modifications were small, it didn't require a lot of work to be implemented and to be ported to new hardware. Now, the basic idea of NetMap, and also the misleading name that I chose, is to use a shared memory region that both the kernel and user space and the user space application can access. And this is represented in this array. And this shared memory region contains three types of objects. The first one is packet buffers, basically where you put your payload. And the packet buffers are the fixed size, sufficient to store full-size packets, so either 2K or if you have jumbo buffer, you need it larger. The second region is called the NetMap ring. The NetMap ring is basically a ring buffer, and it mimics the ring buffer that is managed by the hardware, the network hardware. In fact, both the NetMap ring and the NIC ring point to the same buffer. This is the shared memory region. So the hardware, when it has to send packets, will fetch the data from here, and when it receives the packets, will copy the data here. And these buffers are also accessible from here. The NetMap ring is a circular ring. It's accessed by the kernel and by user space. And there is a third data structure, which is called NetMap IF. And the reason why we have this third data structure is that many modern NICs support multiple rings. One of the features introduced by NIC vendors to improve performance was to support multiple queues, so you can have multiple threads sending or receiving data from the other without the need of synchronizing. And so we need to support it. That's why we have this further structure, which has pointers to all the rings that are supported by the other. Being a circular ring, we have a couple of information in the NetMap ring. I particularly like the, basically this information point to the head of, and the tail of the queue. I particularly like this representation where you have a current pointer to the insert or read or write position and another field which is just a counter of available slots. And then for every slot, you have a very compact and hardware-independent representation. So for every buffer in the system, you have 8 bytes, which contain the actual buffer size. If you want to send packets, the payload length. If you want to receive packets, is how many bytes were received by the hardware. And something that translates to a pointer to the buffer. I write here index, and the reason why I write the index is that this memory region is shared between user space and the kernel, so there are different types of spaces, and they can be mapped in a different point in memory. So if I had put a pointer here, the pointer wouldn't have the same meaning in user and kernel. Having there just an index, it's very easy to translate the index to the proper pointer in user space and in the kernel without too much work. Basically, whenever you have an interface and you want to control it using NetMap, there is this data structure that lets you manage the interface. The NIC ring, which I show here, is a data structure which is also in main memory, but it's not accessible from user space. It's managed by the NIC and by the device driver, and basically points to the same buffers. And we'll see how these two rings, the NetMap ring and the NIC ring, share information. For protection, I said that I want to be safe. I don't want that mistakes in application can crash the system. For protection, we use the standard OS mechanism. So we make sure that the only region exposed to the user space program cannot be accessed in a way that crashes the kernel. For instance, one thing that the NIC ring contains are pointers to physical addresses of these buffers. And the user space program is never allowed to write pointers to physical addresses here. The transfer of information from here to here and vice versa is done by the operating system, by modified device driver. And also when this lets the kernel validate information that the user space provides.
So how do you determine the size of the region?
The size of the region is when you attach to when you open the device in NetMap mode, the kernel defines how big it is.
So it's allocated only once.
It is allocated only once. Yes.
Is there a way to prevent the data from changing between the time that you validate it and the time you use it?
From the payload, no. For the payload, no, but it's part of the contract. I mean, there is no point in making sure that. So, this is an API that lets you send raw packets and makes no restriction on the content of the packets that you send.
It's in the NetMap ring. It says the kernel.
The NetMap ring, yes. The NetMap ring is you read information here only once, And so once you've run it, even if user space changes it, there is no effect in the kernel side. So the other thing we should be careful about is that we have memory region shared between user space and the kernel. And so how do we protect from braces in accessing this data structure? Here the contract is the following. Whenever the user space program is running, so it's not blocked on the system call, then it has full access on part of this ring. Basically, all the area which is marked as available to user space is accessible to user space. And whenever the application is blocked on the system call, which is related to NetMap, then the kernel assumes that nobody is going to touch this information. This said, as said before, all the information here is only read once, and after that, it's just written. So even if user space changes some of the information, it cannot crash the system. The most that can happen is that you have invalidated data sent out, but it's the user space which is sending, which is playing against the system. Another important part in the operating system, you have interrupt service routines, and those run asynchronously with respect to the user space and system call, etc. Unfortunately, they never touch the shared region, so there is no chance of any braces. Now, how do you access a device in NetMap? Basically, the system is very similar to a socket. You try to get a handle to manipulate the device, and then you issue system calls to configure the device, etc. So the handle is returned by an open on a special device name. Then you have an IOCTL, which tells the system which device you want to access in NetMap mode, ETH0 or XL0 or whatever the card name is. And if the card has multiple rings, you might also specify that you want to access a single ring with that file descriptor, or all the rings in the card, or you want to attach to the host stack. I mean, there are some multiple features that you can specify in that mode. Once you have issued the IOCTL, basically the network card is disconnected from the host stack. You have full control on the packet, and you can send and receive packets using this data structure, as I'll show in a moment. Of course, you have to map this region using an NMAP. And the size of the region is returned in the argument of the IOCTL. For transmissions, the first thing you do is fill the buffers with the data, fill the information, the length information in the ring. Current and avail tell the system how many buffers you're going to transmit. And then once you've done this, you can issue an IOCTL to tell the operating system, okay, now take these packets, queue them on the device, and start transmission. And this is a non-blocking system call. On receive, there's a dual IOCTL, which reports the newly received packets. So you can ask the system if there are new packets. The information is copied from here to here. Basically, the important part is the length of the packet. And then current and avail are updated to reflect how many packets you have. Of course, you need synchronization. You don't want to spin on the IOCTL transmit and receive. And we have standard mechanisms in Unix to do that. So NetMap implements that. So basically, when you poll on a NetMap file descriptor, you can specify poll in and poll out, and select is the same. You can specify poll in and poll out to decide whether you want to block on reads or on writes. And whenever you have data available for reception or buffers available for transmission, the poll will return. Poll is whenever the poll blocks, it is woken up by an interrupt coming on the card. So if the card supports interrupt mitigation or moderation, as it's called, those delays are propagated to the user space process, which is very convenient because you can tune the amount of work that you do in user space. Basically, every system call is going to cost you a lot. We have seen 100 nanoseconds plus whatever overhead it is in the kernel to implement the machinery for poll and select. So you want to, in a way, you want to reduce the number of system calls that you do in every second, assuming you have a lot of traffic coming in. And interrupt mitigation is a mechanism that was designed exactly to limit the amount of work that the system does by amortizing the cost of interrupts in that particular case, and of system calls in our case. There is no KQ support. KQ is the mechanism in FreeBSD which is similar to the EPOL in Linux. Support for that will come later. And KQ is, and EPOL are very important when you have many interfaces, many file descriptors to handle within a single call. Multi-core support. Yes, we have multi-queue and multi-core support. Multi-queue is trivial, basically the netmap IF points to the multiple rings, and a single file descriptor can be attached to all the rings, so in which case you issue a call and the call wakes up when any of the rings has room available, or you can attach a specific ring to a file descriptor. So for instance, if you want to share the load on multiple cores, you open multiple file descriptors, attach each to one of the rings in the kernel, and do that. The configuration is done using the ISTL. And now the next problem is, how do I bind those processes which manage the file descriptor to a specific core? And there are standard system calls to do that. In FreeBSD, there is bthread set affinity. In Linux, there is something similar, which I don't remember. So there is no need to introduce any new mechanism. You just use whatever the operating system provides. And you can bind a process to a core, and then you can have that process handle a specific file descriptor. So you can decide how you map the load on your system. Yes.
So in this kind of a system, how do you prevent packet reordering? How are you classifying packets into rings? Because presumably you want like one ring.
That's another of the things that NetMap doesn't do. I mean, NetMap is only concerned with moving packets up and down. Any classification is done by external mechanisms. For instance, some NICs have RSS or other features where they do hash and subdivide traffic into the various queues. And you just reuse that. Linux ATH2 has support for that. So again, I didn't want to reinvent the wheel. There is already something that works and people are familiar with. Just reuse that. How do you talk to the host stack? Now, the question is, when you start the system, the operating system believes that the card is attached, it has an IP address, and possibly there are processing trying to send packets to these out to this card or expecting packets to come in from this card. Now, when you set the interface network mode, you grab the packets that are coming from the card and you take exclusive control of the transmit queues. But the operating system still believes the card is there. And the way NetMap supports this is by creating another couple of NetMap queues which are connected to the host stack, this one and this one. So you can open another NetMap file descriptor which is attached to the host stack, and you can move packets from the card to the host stack just using the same rings that I've shown before. So from the operating system point of view, the card is still there. It's able to send and receive packets. Whenever the operating system wants to send packets, these packets end up in this red queue. A NetMap application can read packets from here, and if it is the case, can decide to forward them to the card. And in the other direction, when there are packets that are coming from the cards and you want to send them to the host stack, you just re-inject in this particular queue and then they will go up to the stack. So for instance, if you want to implement a very fast firewall or something that protects you from attacks or a traffic scheduler or anything, you can use this interface and without changing anything in your applications. Okay, that's what I said before. When you have multiple interfaces, typical thing you want to do is route traffic or bridge traffic between interfaces. So do you need to copy the packets or not? And the answer is no, you don't need to copy packets because the payload is in these buffers and each interface accesses these buffers to these rings. So the thing you can do is just swap the indexes of the buffers between the transmit queue and the receive queue. And in by swapping the indexes, you achieve two results. The first one is that you do a zero copy forwarding. And the second result is that the buffer that was attached to the other queue becomes available for receiving a new packet. So basically, with the buffer swapping, you transmit the packets and you make a buffer available for reception without allocating anything. Sorry, the figure is located. In terms of code size, not that we care much, but I mean, the code is really small. It's less than 2,000 lines of code. And the device driver modification heavily commented are all in the range of a few hundred lines of code. Consider the typical device drivers between 4 and 10,000 lines of code. So the modification are really, really small. And there is no user library for that mapper because the API is really, really simple. So I just have this NetMap user, tiny layer, 100 lines of code. Half of them are probably copyright. And those are macros to access the buffers from the NetMap window. Now, in terms of performance, what I was saying before, when you do packet processing, most of the cost is per packet because you have a system call, because you have processing within the kernel which deals with headers or with metadata, not with the payload itself. So the relevant metric is packets per second, not bit per second. So you find a lot of papers measuring performance in terms of gigabit per second, but when you dig into the paper, you find out that those tests are run with 1500 byte packet or jumbograms, which are almost 10 kilobytes. The numbers here are measured with 64 byte packets. So it's, you know, in terms of packet rates, it's 20 times higher than what you would have with 1500 bytes. And the other thing is, especially in the first measurement, we only measure the packet I/O overhead. If your application is doing intensive data processing, encryption, etc., of course it's going to be slow. But the part we are concerned with NetMap is the after the application, how much it costs you to move the packet from the application to the network or vice versa. That's the part that we are covering here. And the other thing to notice that there are many cards that cannot do line break. Line break is 14.88 million packets per second and 10 gig. If you buy 10 gig hardware, not all of it is able to do line rate in all configurations. Most of them can do line rate with 1500 byte packets, but as you move to shorter packets, they're not able to cope with it. And the reason is sometimes buses don't have enough capacity, internal buses in the card don't have enough capacity, some cards use microcode and the microcontroller into the card, within the card is low, etc. Now, this is the graph we saw before, and so you see that NetMap can send packets, minimum size packets at line rate, even with a highly underclocked CPU.
So I guess one of the reasons that the performance is done in bits per second is because when you do it in packets, I mean, you have to assume some like average packet size, right? Mm. So the bits per second seems to be more like an absolute metric than packets is kind of like relevant.
Well, it depends. Because
it depends on the packet distribution that you're using.
It depends on the packet distribution.
So that's I guess that's why they use it. Right?
Again, it depends on the application. I think this NetMap and all these OS bypass mostly useful when you have to do implement firewall or traffic monitors, mm-hmm. etc. And there you have to deal with worst case situations, which are, you know, tiny grams or 64 byte packets. That's the reason. Now, there are, if I have time, which I don't, but I'd like to show some numbers. There are some cases where you also need to show the performance in bits per second because there are other bottlenecks which are dependent on the packet size.
Well, it's also done for comparison reasons, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know.
Compare like a Cisco box, a Juniper box.
Well, but if you take routing hardware, for instance, there are some RFC which specify you should measure performance with 64, 156,
right.
And
50 bytes.
Now, in terms of a lot of performance in NetMap comes from the use of batches of packets. If you send one packet at a time, you already have to pay the 100 nanoseconds for the system call, and you cannot do line rate. Now, the only way to get decent performance is to send packets in batches. How much is this affected how much is performance affected by the batch size. And so we measure the throughput with different batch sizes, and we see that we can reach line rate with a batch of 8 bytes, 64 byte bytes, for some, 1500 bytes is not a problem. Even Linux or FreeBSD can do that. But with short packets, you are most in trouble. So fortunately, the batch size required to achieve line rate is not huge. On the receive side, you see some artifacts. On the receive side, basically, the problem is that some packet sizes can do, you can get line rate, for some others you can. And the reason is that when the packet size is multiple of cache line size, all the transfers are easy. You just do one write and you're okay. If the packet size is not a multiple of 64, then you need to do multiple transactions on the bus, and those are going to exceed the bandwidth available on the PCI Express bus. Most cards use 4 lanes for each 10 gig port. 4 lanes have a raw capacity of 16 gigabit per second. But of course, if you have to transfer the 10 gigabit per second and the metadata buffer descriptor, etc., and you need to do 2 transactions instead of 1 for each packet, you're going to exceed the available bandwidth. So, for instance, the Intel card that we used had this problem. And so you have to keep that in mind when you run your measurement. At least, I mean, if you know that the card is limited by the bus size, you don't waste months trying to improve the performance for something that is not under your control. In terms of forwarding performance, we took NetMap and compared the performance of packet forwarding with other solutions. So FreeBSD bridging or even Linux bridging, OpenBSD switch, etc., are all in the range of 600 to 800, 900 thousand packets per second. If we take two interfaces, run them in network mode, and connect them with just 2 packet forwarding between them, with the zero copy trick that I showed before, you can move packets at line rate, assuming the packet size is one of the compatible ones with line rate, with one core at 1.7 gigahertz. And of course, if you do some complex processing in the middle, the performance is going to be lower. If you use the leap-pickup emulation library, so there is some overhead, there's an extra copy, etc., you still can do 7.5 million parts per second. These are all data, actually. I think we are slightly faster. And then we took some application and tried to modify them in order to use NetComp. For instance, for OpenBSD switch, we took the user space forwarding plane and moving it to NetMap, even on top of the pickup library. So it's not the most efficient solution that we can have. We reached about 3 million packets per second. So a lot faster than the internal forwarding plane. We took Click, which is probably something some of you have used. Click has a kernel implementation, which is quite fast. The user space implementation, which wasn't so fast because it was based on the pickup, and just adapting it to use the pickup emulation library, we reached about 4 million packets per second. And so you have higher speed than the internal implementation and the convenience of working in Google space. The code is available for, it's part of FreeBSD since the beginning of 2012. There is a Linux version for most kernel from 2.6 to 3.6 on my website. There are even bootable images, so you can take them, run them on your router without having to install things. What's very important to have the bootable images, because it's very critical. In order to get that performance, you need to make sure that the system is configured properly, the device driver is the correct one, and so on. So a lot of feedback I receive when people try to apply our patches is, I apply the patches, I cannot get any performance, I cannot access the device, etc. How comes that bootable images work? Well, probably the documentation was not good enough, but at least this gives people confidence that the numbers are real and they're not fake. Supported hardware. I said that I need a device driver modification. I have changes for the Intel 10 gig and 1 gig card, some patches for Realtek and for NVIDIA, and for other card, I really need programming documentation. Without the manuals of the card, it's lost. Open issues. What how can we use that apart from accelerating packet processing application, click, etc. Well, for instance, you could try to use the NetPub API in the host stack, simplifying the packet, the format of packets, and speeding up the process. Something that we should do is to modify the model of operation. Right now, when you open the interface in NetMap mode, the card is owned by the user space application. It's not, in a sense, available to the rest of the system, other than forwarding the packet through the NetMap. Should extend this in a BPF-like way, so a client opens a card in NetMap mode, the rest of the traffic still goes to the card up and down. Performance, in many cases, is limited by the cost of the system calls. And some of the system calls, especially PON, and especially when you interact with the scheduler to go to sleep and wake up, those system calls are very, very expensive. I'm talking about several microseconds for simple operations like scheduling a new process or going to sleep and waking up, etc. And those are things that are important, for instance, when people care about latency in the communication. We have only covered the throughput, which is great, but the latency is not improving with NetMap. It's just the same latency that you have on the standard system. And that's mostly something that has to be dealt with in the operating system, not in the device level. Current work that we have done, we have, for instance, used the NetMap API to implement a software switch, which is called Vale, which implements a virtual local internet and can be used to interconnect virtual machines. We have a QMO backend to talk about the switch. Can be used to interconnect applications. For instance, if you have a packet processing tool and you want to test its performance, without this tool, you would need a real-time gig or gig or whatever, very fast network and interfaces, etc., and a fast traffic generator. With this tweak, you can take your packet processing application, attach it to one port of this software switch, and attach a packet generator to the other port, and test the performance of your system. This is also part of the standard network distribution, so you can create dynamically many instances of switches. Each switch can have dynamically created ports. And on top of this, for instance, we have implemented a test of the user space version of the IPFW and DummyNet packet scheduler and network emulator, which does several million packets per second per core, which is 5 or 10 times faster than the incumbent version. And so I think I'm out of time. If you want, I can show you some slides on the virtual switch, or otherwise I'm happy to answer questions.
Want? I'd love to see the virtual switch slides.
Okay, that'd be cool. So basically, we try to use the same ideas that we use in NetMap for implementing this virtual switch, and what we have. So the abstraction that we create is this virtual switch. And this virtual switch has a number of network ports. And the idea is whenever an application wants to use a virtual switch, we'll issue the same calls that it would use to access a physical interface. Open that network. In the IOCTL, instead of specifying the interface name, you specify a special name, which is Vale XY, where X is the switch name and Y is the port name within the switch. And the port is created, the switch is created dynamically, and when you have multiple clients attached to the same switch, the switch implements the learning bridge algorithm, the standard internet learning bridge algorithm. And the kind of performance that you can achieve is about 18 million packets per second for small frames. And in terms of bandwidth, because this is one of those cases where the throughput also matters, because you hit against memory bus bandwidth. So this switch can do about 70 gigabit per second with 1500 byte frames. Again, it's part of the standard FreeBSD and Linux module. You don't need any hardware to use the switch. And we also have a QEMU and KVM backend. In terms of performance, or operation, mostly, this is also important. So when all the work is charged on the sender of a packet. So you, when you want to send a packet, the packet is processed immediately and sent to one or multiple destinations. And if you implement a switch in a naive way, you will take a packet, compute a set of destination, and copy to each destination. And this operation would be kind of inefficient. When I say inefficient, operating this way would still reach 5 million packets per second, which is a lot more than the Linux bridge or the previous bridge. But we can do a lot better. We can do almost 20 million packets per second. And the way to improve the performance is to try to amortize the locking overhead and the cache misses that you would have with this scheme. And let's see if I... Okay, so whenever you transmit a packet, what happens is that the kernel receives an FMAP ring with a set of packets that need to be forwarded to the various destinations. So the naive operation would be take these packets, compute the destination, then one at a time block the interfaces and make a copy of the packet, unlock, and move to the next one. Instead of doing this, we first collect a number of packets into a pool of bounded maximum size. Then for each of these packets, while we collect the addresses, we also do a prefetch of the payload, so we amortize the cost of potential cache misses. We compute a set of destinations, but we don't forward immediately. We just compute this array of destination. One bit means that this packet goes to this first port and then nowhere else. This packet goes to all the ports, etc. When it's time to forward, we take the entire batch and we scan the list of interfaces instead of scanning the packets. So we first select the first interface and we lock the interface once, and we forward all the packets that are marked as one here. Then we unlock, move to the next one, and forward all the packets here. And there are some optimizations, so we avoid scanning interfaces that have no packets directed to them. We can start processing not from the first packet, but from the first packet that actually needs to be forwarded to an interface, etc. And by operating this way, we, as I said, we can reach almost four times the speed that we got before. Now, there are a few graphs about performance. The cost of this system is proportional to the number of copies that you do. And so here we compare the performance of our wireless switch with other solution for doing forwarding to multiple destinations. Sometimes are based on the use of the NIC. For instance, many modern 10-gig NIC for multiple queues that can be attached to virtual machine, and the NIC can do the copy from one queue to another one. And doing this is basically a memory-to-memory copy, which is done by the NIC, and it's kind of stupid to do these things this way, because if the NIC has to do a memory-to-memory copy, it has to copy the data through the PCI Express bus and back into the memory. So it goes through the bottleneck, which is a 16 gigabit per second bottleneck, much smaller than the memory bus. So the CPU is a lot faster in doing the copy. And it shows here, for instance, if you have our wireless switch, depending on the number of ports, this is the throughput that you get. If you want to do the forwarding through the PCI Express bus, you get this kind of throughput. It's good. And for instance, if you take the Linux bridging code, it is down here. No surprises, Linux bridging code. Basically, is the cost of the system call and mbuff allocation, etc. Throughput versus packet size, of course, the throughput of this bridging solution depends on the packet size, because you do a memory-to-memory copy somehow, either using the CPU, which is the case for the valet switch, or for the Linux bridge, or you do through the PCI Express bus. And the different slope depends on the memory, on the bandwidth that you have available on the bus that is used for the copy. And then again, a lot of performance comes from batching. So if you move one packet at a time, you're going to be very slow. If you move multiple packets at a time, you're going to be to have a higher throughput. However, the delay also increases because your forwarding is delayed by roughly by the batch size. So you want to have some control over the batch size somehow. At least you want to sysadmin to be able to say, okay, I don't want the batch to be larger than 20 packets or 1,000 packets or 10 packets because I want to control my delay. And so there are parameters in the system that let the system administrator control the batch size. And so I have some graphs that show the performance depending on the batch size used on the receiver or the batch size used on the transmitter or the batch size used on within the kernel. And I mean, you can have a look at the paper for a complete discussion on why the slope is different in the various cases. In terms of latency, which is another thing that matters, the Linux bridge has a latency of about for an application doing a ping-like thing. You send a ping, you send a request and get a response. Minimum size packets. Depending on the packet size, the latency for Linux bridge is about between 7 and 8 microseconds. For the valley switch is between 5, it's around 5 microseconds. But most of this cost is operating system cost. In both cases. So partly slightly more efficient because it doesn't do packet allocation and allocation, but the big chunk is definitely the system core cost. So we need to fix the operating system in order to do it. Yes.
Should we wrap it up to yeah, open sure. up for some more questions?
Sure. Okay, the final slide, just to get an idea of what kind of performance you can get using the valley switch with built-on machines. Basically, if you use VLTIO and KVM, which are the most efficient solution for doing network communication on a virtual machine, you get between 300,000 and 400,000 packets per second. If you have a faster backend, which is the valley switch, you can go up to over 1,000,000 packets per second. And of course, here you're still limited by the speed at which the application within the virtual machine can send packets. If you have a very much faster packet generator within the virtual machine, using the valley switch, you can even go higher than that. Okay, I think I'm done. So you can find a lot of information, the code, papers, the graphs, etc. on my website.
So you had this slide at the beginning with a breakdown of where time is spent in a traditional
yeah.
stack in FreeBSD. And from what you said, it seems that you're doing only the lower stack.
Yeah. So basically,
yep.
what in the application I've been using, basically I don't have this part for UDP, IP, and the initial part of IF at the side. So this part is going away.
Okay, and from this, so what is the, how much did you reduce? How much do you reduce it? And the other question is, based on this architecture in mind, would you do things in the higher stacks differently? So you said that there is this chain, and the chain also goes on how the layering works, right? So each of the layers go and process a different...
Well, one thing in a standard stack, for instance, what I would do is, instead of adding... headers one piece at a time, I would try, well, the first time you send a packet to a destination, you probably don't know which options, TCP option you're going to use, the addresses, etc. But a lot of these operations could be cached and recycled on subsequent attempts. For instance, when you send packets, the typical thing that is done, you make a copy in the buffer, in the escape buffer, and then you do the segmentation when it's after a time to transmit the packet. And segmentation is expensive, you need to touch the data, etc. Once you know the MTU, you know the address, etc., you could as well do the segmentation initially on the system. And similarly, on the receive side, you have a socket buffer. You could probably allocate memory initially and avoid the SK buffer allocation reallocation every time you receive a packet. But in terms of savings, basically all this cost in the device driver is gone. The cost per packet is around 20-25 nanoseconds right now. And mostly because I'm using batches, so I don't need to program the interface on every packet, I need to program the interface on every batch. So This is amortized, the cost up there is amortized, some parts are not there, the memory cut is not there, the locking is not there anymore.
So most network applications use TCP, which sort of requires the Linux network and stack. And do a comparison of like end-to-end TCP throughput over Veil or Vollet versus the Linux bridge. Does it really affect it, or was that pretty much what you were showing that it cuts out the packet delivery overhead as opposed to the overheads in the OS?
It cuts the packet delivery, and so for 1500 or 9K buffers, you don't care because you're already saturating the memory bus, if you're using communicating between the two machines.
So it may not actually make
it difference. May save in terms of CPU cycles, which is always good. But if you just measure the throughput, probably you're not going to see a lot of difference.
So I worked on Mininet, which is a network emulator, and apparently we use Open vSwitch. And I actually want to congratulate you for writing one of the only good things I've read in CACN in years. It's one of the few good things. It's really good. And I want to switch to the OVS using NetMap, but NetMap's not supported in Linux. So I guess two questions. One is, why isn't it in Linux? And two, or I guess when will it be and why not?
Okay, if you can cut off the recording. No, I don't know why it's not supported in Linux. I submitted it to the Linux Center, please. It wasn't even considered. I'm not playing by the rules. I'm just sending the code and saying, if you want to, feel free to use it or adapt it, etc. There is one reason why it might not be accepted. NetMap is basically written for FreeBSD. It uses the internal FreeBSD APIs, the coding convention, etc. And it's another language. So people reading Linux code are not familiar with the FreeBSD instruction. I have a small layer which adapts FreeBSD calls to the Linux calls, and that's very, very convenient for me because, for instance, when I wrote Vale, I developed it on FreeBSD, and once it was ready to debug on FreeBSD, I just compiled it on Linux and it worked without any changes. That was great. If I had two different versions, I would have wasted a lot of time to this part, etc. So I have a strong incentive of not having two different versions, and the Linux people probably don't like the style, whatever. The good part is that Vale doesn't make any change to the system. So if you don't need to use the device driver, you just load the NetMap module and you have NetMap and Vale, and you're fine. So being outside the mainstream Linux is not the main problem in that case. It's only for device drivers. And for device drivers, the patches are really small. So they mostly apply to multiple versions without much problem. So one of the things that I want to do is to extend Vale and replace the learning bridge that I have inside with the Open vSwitch for what it could. I don't know how much it could be, but hopefully not a lot.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.